Hey guys, it's Celestia, and I am once again out here digging up a dead horse just to beat it. But this is the content that my view count says you guys want, so I'm gonna do it. Which is exactly the problem that I'm here to talk about today. Now, to be clear, I am not calling you guys out. No more than I'm calling myself out for talking about it or any other creator for doing the same. I'm gradually coming to the conclusion that so long as no individual creators are being targeted and harassed, it's not necessarily a bad thing to create or consume negative content, despite my prior intentions to focus almost exclusively on the positive. At least part of the reason that people enjoy watching negative content is because negative things happen, and they should be discussed and contemplated and resolved rather than ignored. And that's valid. I don't think there's anything wrong with enjoying or making content that isn't inherently positive all the time, so long as it doesn't hurt anyone. And I'm not trying to diminish the validity of that with this video. But let's be honest, when I say the art community loves drama, everyone knows I don't just mean respectful discussion of drama-related issues that doesn't name or insult any individual creators. We all know that at least half, and that's being generous, of the drama this community enjoys is objectively slanderous, damaging, petty, and unproductive. So let's talk about why we enjoy it anyway. And the first answer to why does the art community love drama that comes to mind is because every community does, which is not untrue. This problem is by no means limited to the art commentary community, and the underlying pattern is clear throughout pretty much any of them. Whether it's makeup, gaming, hell, even tech reviews. The actual subject matter that brought the community together, and continues to do so, is actually not the main focus. The main focus is, with almost textbook consistency, the drama and discourse that take place between the biggest creators in those communities. So while what I'll be discussing today is based on my experiences with the art commentary community, I do recognize that it's a pattern of behavior that's not limited to it, and I don't mean to single the ArtCC out or call them out any more than I'm calling out any other online community. We're not worse than everyone else, we're just not better. Now, before I talk about why the audience enjoys drama, let's actually start with why there's so much drama-related content there for them to enjoy in the first place. Why do creators make it? Well, the answer is actually pretty straightforward. It appeals to almost everyone. For art commentary channels, we're in kind of a difficult position. Art commentary is an umbrella term that contains a huge, huge variety of topics and interests. And even if you build an audience that enjoys art commentary content, there's only a small fraction of that audience that will enjoy each individual topic you discuss that falls into that category. For example, my videos that discuss Artist Alley, conventions, and industry work all get significantly less views, because while they're art commentary, they appeal to only a small few of the people who subscribe to me and enjoy art commentary content. Comparatively, my videos discussing social media or art advice do better because they're less specific and therefore appeal to a larger audience. But I'm sure you guys can all guess pretty goddamn easily what types of videos of mine have gotten the most views, and they're drama-related videos and storytime videos. And that's because those are the videos that appeal to almost everyone within that art commentary audience umbrella. Because it doesn't matter if a viewer does digital or traditional art, uses social media, sells at conventions, wants art advice, or so on. Almost all of them can find something interesting in a video about drama or personal stories. Which is actually a good point of reference. When I say that drama videos perform best amongst all types of art commentary videos for a reason, it's for the exact same reason that storytime videos do. They establish a connection to art with the speed paints in the background without narrowing down their audience by talking about any particular aspect of art, and instead establish a personal connection between themselves and the viewer. And just like how I'm constantly talking about how a personal connection is the main selling point for art, it's also the main selling point for content. So that means everything here. Now, you may be wondering what I mean when I say that drama content establishes a personal connection between the creator and the viewer if the creator isn't actually involved in the drama and is just discussing it. Well, if you think about it objectively, a personal connection is established whenever you agree or disagree with someone. If you agree with someone, you feel like you can relate to them. If you disagree with someone, you feel animosity towards them. Both of those results mean more views for the creator. People hear personal connection and think it has to mean something genuine and meaningful, like a storytime video might be able to establish through shared or similar experiences, but it doesn't have to be that deep. Drama videos establish that same kind of personal connection just by taking one side or the other, and that's why creators keep making them. And again, I can't reiterate this enough, I'm not condemning creators for wanting to make a good business decision and seek out that personal connection and subsequently the views and subscribers that come with it. I get it, and I wouldn't be making this video if I didn't. Creators who want to make something of themselves and their careers on YouTube have to take things like that into account. And it doesn't mean they're selling out or aren't passionate about what they make. It means they're so passionate about the content they're creating that they want to be able to make it full-time, and that means making money from it. And if there's a type of content within the art commentary niche that allows them to grow and make money from it, they should not be condemned for pursuing that opportunity. They're valid, and just like the audiences that enjoy that content, I'm not trying to insult or demean them. I'm just trying to take a deeper look into the psychology of why this happens so consistently and prolifically. I will, however, criticize creators who target other artists in the community directly, blatantly, and harmfully for the sake of pursuing that gain. I am 100% confident that if I had thrown my morals away and talked about the plethora of art commentary dramas that have happened in the past year directly, calling out every single creator involved and taking a subjective stance on it, I would have doubled my current view and subscriber count, if not more. It's the easy way out, and I understand the appeal of that. But when taking the easy way out means throwing other creators under the bus regardless of what the truth of their situation really is, yeah, I'm unapologetic in my decision to say that that's scummy and should be looked down on. I don't mean creators who discuss specific dramas and creators objectively and respectfully, to be clear. For example, the Hopeless Peaches drama. I don't support creators like prison mate Luke, who threw their peers, Peaches in this case, under the bus with slander and ableism without presenting the situation with any degree of objectivity or respect. I do support creators like Mally Malware, who addressed the situation by taking it apart in an in-depth series of videos that showed and explained every side equally, without letting their personal opinions influence the way they discussed it, and without insulting the people involved. There's a very, very significant difference there that needs to be considered, and I want to make it abundantly clear that when I criticize creators like Luke, I don't mean to throw creators like Mal under the bus. Honestly, I think this cycle is why so many art commentary channels end up turning into regular commentary or even tea channels. It's so, so hard to grow your channel while sticking exclusively to art commentary related topics, and making one video about drama that gets 10 times the amount of views and engagement as your normal content is understandably liable to tempt you into making more and more and more. And honestly, I struggle to blame them, even if it's not my thing personally. Because wanting to succeed at the thing you're pouring your heart and soul into is a hard motivation to fault. But now that we've gone over why creators keep making drama-related content, let's talk about why audiences continue to eat it up. This is the section where I say a bunch of stuff that might offend people, so before I do that, let me just clarify that this is a lot of generalization. When I talk about people for the next bit here, I mean most people. So if you don't do or feel the same things as the people I'm referring to, then please know that you're not the kind of person I'm referring to, and I don't mean to make any actual, genuine generalizations about people or behavior. I just mean the majority when I say people. So, why do viewers enjoy drama content? Why do you guys keep watching these videos more than my other ones? Well, aside from the personal connection I've already mentioned, there are actually a bunch of different reasons that viewers might prefer these kinds of videos. And the first of which is that people would rather focus on the problems and controversies of others to distract themselves from their own. Fundamentally, YouTube dramas are no different than an episode of Riverdale. It's entertaining for however long you spend watching it, but the people involved are nothing more than characters that can entertain you by either being a good guy or a bad guy and doing outrageous things, and they disappear when the episode ends. Bad analogy, because Riverdale has gotten so bad that even my dumb, dedicated ass can't keep watching it, even just to laugh at it, but still, the point stands. Because viewers don't see themselves as the same as creators due to the disconnect that arises from parasocial relationships, it's alarmingly easy to instead view creators as nothing more than characters to enjoy as entertainment. And it's scarily easy to forget that when you turn off a video slandering an artist for something they may not have even done, you can go back to your everyday life. They have to live with the hate, harassment, and cruelty that follows in the aftermath. And with that in mind, another big reason that I found that viewers enjoy drama in the art community is a clear black and white good guy bad guy narrative appeals to most people. It's why every movie or show has a protagonist and an antagonist. They want the viewer to take a side and root for that side, and drama does nothing if not indulge and take advantage of that. But unlike fictional narratives in which one person is wrong and the other person is right, the reality of most real-life dramas is that both people are wrong and both people are right. right, and that the situation is so fundamentally nuanced and complicated that there is quite simply no right answer. In real life, one person is never 100% valid and correct and righteous, while the other is villainous and heinous and wrong, and everyone involved is usually somewhere in between both extremes, sometimes both at once. But it's easier to be mad at the villain and defend the hero, and it's harder to recognize that neither are only what they appear to be. And given that YouTube dramas basically exist for the sake of viewer entertainment, viewers tend not to want to hear the actual facts of the situation that might detract from the straightforward, easily resolved narrative depicted. And subsequently, creators don't want to depict it that way. This also feeds into the fact that most people tend not to want a resolution to the situation nearly as much as they want to be mad about it. That's why there are so many Karens out there. They'd rather be mad that their Starbucks order was wrong than actually get their order corrected. Fixing a problem takes effort, understanding, compromise, and acceptance of the fact that no one in a situation is completely right about their opinion on it, including the viewer. And given that that's not easy or entertaining, and people generally only watch videos like that for easy entertainment, that's usually not what they want. This particular variety of Karen wants to be able to click away from the video after 10 minutes and forget about it, not develop a complex and nuanced perspective on the situation that allows for everyone involved to grow and change for the better. Another reason many people tend to enjoy drama is because, and I mean this as kindly as I can possibly mean it, people like judging each other. Who doesn't want to feel morally, emotionally, and intellectually superior to someone else? Obviously, it's not a good thing, but I recognize that every single one of us has, consciously or subconsciously, fallen victim to that mentality at least a couple times. Especially if you're not the most confident or secure person, watching drama videos and feeling like you can judge someone for doing a bad thing because the narrative paints them as the objective bad guy can understandably feel reassuring. You can point to the bad person and the bad thing they did and feel better about yourself because you'd never do that, and you feel confident in the assertion that at least you're better than them. And while I can understand the mentality and insecurity behind that, it's something I really believe all of us need to try to be more conscious of so that we can avoid doing it, because not only does it just add more fuel to the fire of toxic cancel culture, it's not a healthy outlook on things, especially when the disconnect between creator and audience leaves us often falling back on the false, baseless belief that we're in any position to judge these canceled individuals based on the fraction of their identity that we're aware of, and the one-sided narrative that we're being sold. And not to mention the fact that anonymity means we don't have to worry about being called hypocritical for judging people for doing things that we ourselves have probably done without the eyes of the internet holding us accountable for it. All of this kind of circles around the central theme of cultural disposability that's developed since the internet became what it is today. As a society, we're very unattached to the things that we have, consume, identify with, or enjoy, because ultimately, due to the sheer speed at which everything is changing and developing, we have to be in order to be adaptable. We upgrade our phones too quickly to get attached to one. We replace everything we own with a newer model when one comes out. We change the very way that we present ourselves based on whatever the majority says is the most correct and acceptable way at any given time. And most relevantly, we replace the celebrities, influencers, and creators that we follow with new ones whenever the old ones do something bad. And when we're done with those things, we throw them out and move on, even if it means throwing out pieces of our own identities. Or, in the case of dramas, throwing out not only your support for a creator, but their very humanity. Suddenly, they're not a person anymore. They're a villain. And because the court of public opinion shifts so quickly and radically every single day, we've become accustomed to just throwing out the people we look up to rather than giving them a chance to change and improve. Why bother with the effort? We'll find someone else to support instead in a matter of minutes, and then the cycle will repeat when they get canceled too. So much of what we do and how we do it is based on everything we value being disposable and replaceable, and creators have unfortunately been categorized as more of a commodity to be enjoyed and then replaced than a human being that can make mistakes while still being redeemable and worthwhile. Finally, while a lot of these reasons so far have been less than flattering to audiences and creators alike, this last reason that both groups enjoy drama is both the most common reason and the most defensible reason, in my opinion, and it's that we want change, and we want justice. Sometimes it isn't about trying to demonize a creator. It's about something bigger than that. I was talking about this with my mom recently, and she brought up a really insightful point. This generation is dealing with an exceptional number of social issues that, for the most part, are too huge for any of us to feel like we can really fix. This is the first generation that has a powerful, accessible outlet, the internet, that we can use to tackle social issues and discuss them. And while that's a good thing, it means that we're pretty much more aware than ever of how absolutely fucking terrible the state of the world is. And while we can talk about it and try to help fix things where we can, for the most part, we're just drowning in the hopelessness of all of these cripplingly depressing, heartbreaking problems without any real way to solve any of them. And that leaves the majority of us feeling powerless and desperate to be able to make some kind of positive change in the world. So when controversies happen, some of us are inclined to turn those smaller issues into much bigger deals, so that we can feel like we're actually able to make some kind of big, real, good change by canceling that person. It's well-intentioned, even if it's damaging, and should obviously try to be stopped. And when it comes to this reason, I can't stress enough that it's more than understandable, and I am truly sympathetic to anyone who feels that way. Again, we should be striving to avoid toxic cancel culture, no matter how valid our reasons for indulging in it are. But there is value in acknowledging that for some people, the reasons they gravitate towards drama are just as nuanced as the controversies themselves. Anyway, that's pretty much it from me on this, at least for now. Sociologically speaking, it's been really interesting to take an objective look at drama and the biggest motivators for it, at least in my opinion. And it's also been nice to take a step back and view it from a more detached, analytical standpoint, rather than getting all heated about my personal opinions on how these things should be handled. It's kind of refreshing not to take a stance on how they should be handled at all, but rather just contemplate why they happened in the first place. What are your guys' thoughts on this? Why do you think creators and viewers are so obsessed with drama, both within the art community and in general? Do you personally enjoy it, and why or why not? I'm always interested in hearing your thoughts, so please let me know in the comments, because I imagine this topic is both controversial and complicated enough for me to have overlooked a great deal of potential angles. Anyway, thank you guys for watching, and as always, big thank you to my channel members, Café Soleil, Lotus Dreams Art, Joseph Solomon, and Adele Juarez for their support. Please leave a like and subscribe, and I'll see you in my next video.